This is hands down my favorite talk on sanitation. Hopefully you guys will, for everybody who's not here, will get to see it on the lecture capture. And I know you guys are recording it for Dane County today too. I'm gonna let you introduce yourself a little bit, if that's all right.
Okay. We're gonna spike Dr. Nimmer's Labrador with this product, which is called Glow Germ. And it fluoresces violently under a Woods lamp. And it's really a great little tool to test yourselves and test your staff on efficacy of cleaning. So you can sprinkle it on a Labrador and then serve cupcakes, and then you can light up with a Woods lamp where the glow germ has got. And then we did this once. We served pizza, and somehow, like, not only was it all over my pizza, even though I thought I washed my hands, it was on my eyebrow, and there was some on my hair, and there was some all over the bathroom where we all went to wash our hands. So a lot of fun for under $10. They have this is like dandruff form, but they also have it in snot form in a liquid that you can sprinkle, like spray a little bit on the back of a cage, and I'll just pass this and you can pass it around.
We forgot the Labrador by accident.
We forgot the Labrador, so you have to visualize it. Anyway, it's great to be here. You know, it was, I guess, 12 years ago that I was working as the veterinarian in the Dane County Humane Society, and I was asked to come give a talk to the Companion Animal Club, and I had never given a talk before. And I had thought of this thing called shelter medicine that I didn't know anyone else had thought of. And I came and gave a lecture about it, and Sandra, who was a student, came up to me afterwards and said, "Hey, I think I want to do that too." And here we are, 12 years later, and we have shelter medicine classes at over half the vet schools in the United States, and it's a real thing, and there's a whole body of knowledge that I have to share with you, so it's great. Never think there's any idea too crazy to pursue. That's the moral of that story. And this is a fun lecture. I think that one of the things that's kind of both good and alarming about sanitation is it's one of the things I think we do worst in veterinary medicine. We spend a lot of time and a lot of money, and pump a lot of chemicals into the environment, sometimes without any benefit, and sometimes with actual harm. And it's one of the areas where you can spend the same time and money and have a much better effect, or even spend less time and money and do less harm. So, the theory is good. We do want to create sanitary environments. We want to protect animals from disease. We want to protect staff and visitor health. We want to create an environment where people want to come and spend time. It smells good, it looks good, and we don't have people going home and getting sick. And we want to protect the environment and use resources wisely. We don't want to contaminate our waterways or harm our animals with exposure to chemicals. But it's not completely benign, these chemicals that we're throwing around in this process that we do, which of necessity means interacting closely with contaminated environments. At best, it could just be a waste of time. Here's three staff members, all of whom at the time were making more than a shelter medicine resident, spending all morning cleaning a cat room. And here's a culture from the back of one of the cat cages. So that process just wasn't working, and it was costing a lot of time and money. Could actually freak out the animals. So this little dog that's just cowering in the process, I think actually the squeegee might be being used to squeegee the dog around the cage. But here's a cat who's escaped from its cage in the process of cleaning, and now people are hunting for it using rabies poles. It's racing around under here. Not only is it getting exposed to a lot of disease, but it's undergoing a very stressful experience. And we've done some noise studies and just found that there's a huge spike in noise during cleaning time, and that can be especially a factor for the well-being and health of cats in shelters. Could just fail to work. This is a wet spot. These aren't all actually from the same outbreak, but there's a wet spot in a little divot in a kennel, and we cultured it. Even though it was freshly cleaned and there was a little disinfectant left in the wet spot, and we got the same bacteria out of it that was killing dogs in that shelter. So even though they were cleaning every day, the pathogen was lingering in the environment. could actually directly harm the animals. So that's a scrotal chemical burn. And this is from quaternary ammonium toxicity. This was called into us as an outbreak of possible fatal systemic virulent feline calici virus. It had affected about a dozen cats in this shelter, and one had died of pneumonia. And before they freaked out and took drastic measures with the remaining cats, we went out and looked, and we found a bottle of disinfectant with the lid that had fallen off. It had gotten concentrated and applied at inappropriate concentrations. And just 3 days of antibiotics and pain control and bathing these cats and rinsing the environment was enough to turn that situation around, but it could very easily have been a fatal situation. And it could just efficiently spread disease. There's no other thing that we do really that could be as efficient as cleaning in spreading disease. This was some filthy mop water that was on its way from a ward where there had been parvo to clean the puppy ward that day. Here's dishes being bathed in a broth of litter pan debris before they're redistributed to the animals. Here's just full body contact with a cat that needs to be removed from its cage for cleaning with all the exposure that that entails. And here you can just see from all the dog prints, this is a shelter that has single runs, and so the dogs have to come out of the runs for cleaning, and while they're there, they're exposed to whatever is in the common walkways. So, sort of a to-do list. And I encourage you, wherever you end up in practice or in a shelter, to really take it on, to look at your sanitation protocols, because this can be so rewarding and so easy. Think about, what are the opportunities for disease transition? What do we even need to be worried about? Don't over-clean, don't over-sanitize. Then identify obstacles. Some of the really common obstacles are single compartment housing, so whether it's dogs or cats, if they have to be removed from their cages for daily cleaning, then that's going to pose some kind of a problem that has to be addressed, because it can't be put in a contaminated environment during cleaning, and it's hard to clean something, one animal after another, while you're in the middle of daily cleaning, like some common holding pen or an outdoor area. Poorly cleanable surfaces are another obstacle that needs to be addressed. So if there's dirt or cracked concrete or wood in the environment, you're going to need to think about a special approach. There's only some chemicals that are appropriate. Or you might think about, as a long-term plan, actually creating housing with more cleanable surfaces when infectious disease is really a big concern. And the other thing that's going to be an issue, especially if you're working with shelters potentially, is just limited staff. You can come up with the best cleaning protocol in the world, but if there isn't the staff to carry it out, then it's just not going to work. So you have to think about something potentially that's very simple, that's very quick, and that's going to work for the facility and staffing that you're dealing with. Then choose the right product, something that's going to be effective under the conditions that you're dealing with, and the right process for application. Think about what are the right places to focus your efforts. And not just surfaces, but also people, hands, feet, clothing. What are the things that create the most risk in that particular environment? Write it all down, and then, this is probably the most important part, watch the process from time to time and see what's really happening. And I remember when I was the veterinarian at Dane County and we had a parvo outbreak, and I had never thought about the animal control vehicles. And I'd been there for about 10 months at the time. And I finally asked, well, how are the animal control vehicles being cleaned? And the answer was, well, they aren't really routinely cleaned. There just wasn't a great place. There wasn't a process set up. It just wasn't a habit at that time. And I'm guessing it probably is now. But I just never thought to systematically review the process. And so even though we were spending all this energy bleaching everything in sight within the shelter itself, the very first surface that animals saw when they were coming into the shelter, the animal control truck, before they were vaccinated, before their health was evaluated, that wasn't being routinely cleaned, and that was undermining all our other efforts. So watch the process, know it from start to finish. And then use products like Glowgerm to actually check to see that it's working. So let's think about disease transmission in shelters. Which of these is important for disease transmission for shelter dogs? Clothing, dogs have a lot of contact with people's clothing in shelters? Yeah, like one-on-one, heavy duty, high surface contact with clothing. How about direct contact? Some shelters, not so much. You know, if a shelter has double-sided runs and so the dogs stay in there during cleaning, then direct contact can be very planned. Dogs only have direct contact with each other, maybe in a play group after their health has been evaluated. So in some shelters, this isn't a big issue. We don't have to think about it. But be aware, here's a dog being tied out for cleaning and enjoying a little tongue-to-tongue contact with his neighbor. So even if they're in individual runs, direct contact may sometimes be an issue. We have to think about that. Droplet spread, less than 5 feet, for sure, they can spray a booger across an aisle very easily. Feet and floors. Dogs have contact with surfaces where feet go. And so if feet are walking in and out of kennels, and they walk in and out of 20 kennels, and that surface isn't sanitized afterwards, then every dog is exposed to 20 kennels worth of feet. So we do have to think about feet when it comes to dogs. Exam surfaces, yeah. Airborne spread, greater than 5 feet. Is that important with dogs? Who wants to venture? No, it's not important. Take a guess. Who says yes, it is important? Yes, you're right. Airborne spread with dogs is important. They can transmit disease 25 to 40 feet. So even when we're very attentive to cleaning, if they're housed in the same airspace, we may have some continued disease. What about cats? Clothing. Huge for cats. Because what do they do when they're stressed? They eject their hair. They actually tense their little erector pili muscles and shed actively more when they're stressed. And what do they do as soon as you put them down? They lick their bodies all over and they take in whatever they've just been exposed to. And where do they sit in a small cage in a shelter or a teaching hospital or a veterinary clinic? Litter box. So what's on their hair? Poop, saliva, dandruff, ringworm. It's all there, and it's all on our clothing, and it all gets transmitted when we handle cats. So, you know, in the human world, we think about hands as this big thing, and we, you know, even shelters, we run around, we wash our hands, we sanitize our hands, but, you know, in the human world, we don't pick up our patients and, like, trying to look around like this. And they don't lick themselves all over when we set them down again. So we have a much bigger challenge with cats and dogs than we have in human health. What about direct contact? You know, we don't set down to put cats out in playgroups as much, though we sometimes do. But often they're individually housed, especially when they're sort of in their first days of care, in a shelter or when they're housed in a veterinary clinic. But here's a cat who's actually being treated for ringworm. That's what that little orange sign says. Who's sharing it with the inmates just above. So occasionally it can happen even in single housing. Droplet spread less than 5 feet. Can cats do that? Yes, indeed. They can hurl a booger 5 feet as well. Feet and floors. How much contact do cats have with feet and floors? How about here? Do they contact the floors? Ideally, no. It's not the plan. So at this shelter, it was the plan, and this is a terrible plan. It's okay to let cats out of cages for some exercise and socialization, but uncontrolled during cleaning, when litter is being sifted out onto the floor and it's all dirty from all the hair and dander and sneezings that's gone on overnight, then letting kids run around uncontrolled and poke their hands into other cages is not the time. So having an area set aside, like maybe that's fenced off or a big cage, I'm a huge fan of that. Cats get a little out of cage time, but they get it in an uncontrolled way. This is not a solution for cleaning. But in general, we don't need to worry about like feet. We don't have to have foot baths in a shelter or veterinary clinic environment when we're dealing with cats, unless we are dealing with something truly, truly awful where we can't risk even a particle or two escaping in and out. exam supplies. How about airborne spread greater than 5 feet? Here's a cat that's doing its very best. Can it shoot that more than 5 feet? Can it shoot it 20 feet down the hall? How many say yes? How many say no? Cats can't do it. Their little lungs are too cute and small to really generate a true aerosol. So there's a good advantage that we have with cats. Although we have this challenge of their hair and spread by that means, there actually isn't true airborne spread of feline disease. So, feline forest. And thinking about upper respiratory infection in particular, which I'll talk about even more extensively tonight, it's one of my favorite subjects. But what's the single most important source of feline upper respiratory infection in shelters? What do you think? Yes, single most important cause, herpes virus. And single most important way they get it?
Say louder.
Another infected cat.
Another infected cat? Any other guesses?
Stress.
Our studies have shown that it seems to be much more common for them to bring in their own herpes and express it because they get stressed in the shelter environment. So we see that herpes is much, much more common as a cause of shelter upper respiratory infection than the other virus, feline calicivirus. Feline calicivirus is very easily spread from cat to cat, more easily than herpes because it's a more durable virus. We don't see it nearly as much in shelters, most likely because herpes, unlike calici, is specifically activated by stress. And so, including the stress of cleaning, sometimes when we are really focused on keeping the environment very clean, it's noisy, it's disruptive, it means pulling the cat out potentially of its little safe haven that it's in. And that in itself may well be a more powerful method to cause upper respiratory infection in cats than disease transmission per se. So for cats, and this is just a study that looked at herpes and calici at week 0 versus week 1. And this is pretty typical from what we see in a shelter that's not experiencing a serious outbreak of calici virus, which is most shelters most of the time. The prevalence of calici virus really didn't change very much, whereas the prevalence of herpes virus went from 4% to a little over 50%. And that was in the shelter where I showed you the three animal control officers all cleaning together, make a bunch of noise, a bunch of ruckus, spraying chemicals everywhere. And all of that was probably actually contributing to the increased frequency of disease. So we have to have sort of different strategies for sanitation when it comes to dogs versus cats. For instance, with dogs, it's very important if you walk into their run that when you walk out, you're walking out through a sanitized environment, and you're leaving a sanitized environment behind because you walked in with stuff on your shoes. So you should be cleaning it out and sanitizing it as you leave or after you leave. With cats, what you really need, and this is a bunny, I'm not going to pull you, but we really need to think about housing and environments that facilitate cleaning with minimal disruption. And one of the most powerful things that we do recommend is spot cleaning for cat cages. This is one of our most, this is probably our most frequently asked question. Variations on what should we use? Just want to run information about this disinfectant bite. The name of it is, who knows, it's dimethyl ethyl benzyl ammonium chloride. How about ZEP? How about kennel care? Here's actinyl dimethyl benzyl ammonium chloride, dimethyl ethyl benzyl ammonium chloride. Is that going to work? How about trifectant? So here's something, it says kills all known germs. If only. I mean, you know, but it probably kills cats and puppies too.
Usually they say 99.9%.
Yes. Just as there's no one, like I can't say, here's the right antibiotic without knowing what disease you're treating. There's no one absolutely right, all the time, product that I can just say to use this one, it kills all known germs. So we want to think about the activity of the product. We need something to clean, We need something that disinfects. Sometimes we need something heavy duty to degrease, and sometimes we need something to deodorize. Those are not the same products necessarily, and it's rare to find a single product that's really good at all of those functions. And some products really have only one of those functions, like Dawn dish soap. It's only a cleaner, it's not a disinfectant at all. Bleach, only a disinfectant, not a cleaner at all. And so there's a lot of sloppiness of like, you say, well, we cleaned it with bleach. Well, you can't clean anything with bleach, so what did you do? You know, you want to be really clear about the role of the different products that are available. And then you need to be aware of the spectrum of effect. So unenveloped viruses are notoriously tough characters to kill, and what's an unenveloped virus of importance in veterinary medicine?
Parvo.
Yep. And what is that for cats? Panleukopenia. Khaleesi virus also is an unenveloped virus, so always a presence with cats. And ringworm, even harder to kill than parvo and Khaleesi virus. And then some of the parasite cysts and so on also can be very challenging to get rid of. So be aware that not one product is going to kill absolutely everything and be safe to use. Sometimes you just have to mechanically remove it from the environment using a cleaner and plain old elbow grease. Need to think about contact time. How much time do you have for it to work? If it's something for hand, you don't have time for 10-minute contact time. Something in a foot bath, something for an exam surface where you're busy and moving animals on and off the exam surface. If it has a 10-minute contact time, it's just not going to be effective. Activity in the face of organic matter, that's something that has a big effect on the activity of disinfectants and their ability to work. So some of them are very inactivated by organic matter. And if you have an environment where organic matter is just going to be present, if you've got a lawn that some parvo puppies were out on, if you have a cat tree and you had an outbreak of Khaleesi virus and got to somehow sanitize that cat tree, you're not going to get rid of all the organic matter, so you need to use something that has good activity with organic matter. Penetration into porous surfaces, so if you're working with an environment where there's unsealed concrete or there's wood or the like, then you need a product that's going to be relatively good. So in an ideal world, we just wouldn't have porous surfaces in an area where you have a lot of concerns about infectious disease, but oftentimes we don't live in an ideal world, and so we need to think about that. That's one of our challenges. Then ease of application, if it's hard to do and it's reliant on volunteers or staff with not a lot of training or just not a lot of time, then it needs to be real simple and real quick to apply. Need to think about the potential toxicity if it's going to be around animals, and of course we need to consider the cost. What's the most expensive product we could possibly use? Be the one that doesn't work, right? Because if we're having outbreaks of parvo or ringworm, or we're spreading Khaleesi virus to clients, pet cats, and they're going home and dying, it doesn't matter that we save 22 cents a gallon on the product. It's going to cost us a whole lot more in the long run. So cost is important, but it has to be cost effective. There is no need to rotate disinfectants per se, though. So you want to use the right product for the situation. And if you're normally using a product that's good against unenveloped viruses, but it's not a great degreaser, it's not a very powerful cleaner, then occasionally coming through with a degreaser is good. Or if all of a sudden you have a Giardia outbreak and your usual disinfectant isn't so great against Giardia, then you might want to choose something else. You might want to have several products on hand to use. But we don't have pathogens developing resistance to disinfectants in the same way that they do with antibiotics. So it's not a good idea to use bleach 1 week and a quaternary ammonium compound the next week. It's just going to confuse staff and require two different application methods, and it's going to lead to the wrong concentration being used. So for general cleaning, find a product that's appropriate, create a good protocol, and stick with it as long as it's working. So here are some of the common options that are used. Alcohol. How many of you are familiar with BruClean? You ever seen that one? It's in the bleach family, but it comes in a little tablet form. How about WisiWash? That's also in the bleach family, but it's calcium-based instead of sodium-based. That also comes in a tablet form. Good old bleach. How about trifectin? Any of you use trifectin? So a lot more of you are familiar with trifectin. Quaternary ammonium, you guys know what that is? Maybe you use Rocal or Kennel Care or Triple Two or A33 or Maxon or Zep or Lemon Quad or Parasol. It's the most common. What's used here, do you know?
I think they use Rocal.
Rocal? Okay, so we're using Quad here. It's what we use also. We might be in the process of changing. Any of you familiar with accelerated hydrogen peroxide or Excel? That's a pretty new product in the United States. It has a lot of promise. Chlorhexidine, a lot of you are familiar with it. More commonly used as a pre-surgical scrub. It's gentle on hands and skin and on the environment and on pathogens, so not a very good killer, not a good disinfectant. So, not really a good choice for environmental disinfectant. Just doesn't have a sufficient spectrum of effect. Alcohol, also not a good environmental cleaner, although decent for hands. Yeah, question.
We use HQD. What would that fall under? I have no idea what that
anything with initials like HQD, I'm going to give, I would bet $100 that it's a quad.
It is a quad. That's Dane County, right?
Right. It's a quad. Okay, so that's...
Yeah, so it's in the quaternary ammonium family.
Because we switch back and forth from bleach to HQD.
Yep. So... And quaternary ammonium, although they're common, there are some issues with them. So I'm going to take them off the list of, like, rock-solid choices. There's some issues with all of these, in fact, and we've just updated our big disinfectant comparison sheet, so it's like shopping for a car now. We can go and look at the different, all these classes of disinfectants, and what are their strengths and what are their weaknesses. But we're left with really this group that is reliably effective against unenveloped viruses. So if you've got parvo, panleukopenia, or calicivirus virus that you're concerned about, really we want to be using one of these. Or if we're using one of the other ones, we want to be following it with one of these. So the quads usually have something in them that ends in onium or inium. That's the way you can recognize them. So if it's dodecamethyl bifurcated ammonium. Or aluminium. That's going to be a quat. And they're mixed with all different things, and there's like super activated and ultra foaming quats, but it comes down to basically one of these ingredients. Those are some examples. And some good things about quats. They have modest detergent activity, so they actually are cleaners as well as disinfectants on a lightly soiled surface, and especially the more expensive ones. They're used at a relatively low dilution, that are only diluted 1 to 16, 1 to 32, instead of like 1 to 256. Those are relatively good cleaners. They have decent efficacy in the presence of organic matter, so unlike bleach, they're not completely inactivated by organic matter. And there's a lot of different ways to apply them, and that's one of the reasons that people like them. They can be in hose end things, they can be in big central systems, they can be in a little spray bottle, put them in a bucket, so lots of ways to use them. And they're labeled as one-step cleaner disinfectant products because they have that detergent activity. But, and it's a big but, starting back in 1980 at the Cornell Feeling Health Lab, they were doing some work with calicivirus, and they noticed that it continued to merrily spread in spite of their efforts with a quaternary ammonium disinfectant that was labeled as effective against calicivirus and other unenveloped viruses. So they tested it, and they put it up against bleach and some other disinfectants, and they found that, in fact, it didn't work as labeled. So that label was pulled from the quads. Then they were all reformulated, another dodecadimethyl component was added in there, and they were relabeled as effective against unenveloped virus. So then there was another study in 1995 that tested them and found, indeed, they did not work as labeled. The label was pulled, they were all reformulated, they were relabeled, and then here is a study in 2002 that found, indeed, they did not work as labeled. Label was pulled, reformulated in 2009, indeed, did not work as labeled. Against unenveloped viruses, there are products out there that are reformulated, that are labeled. You decide. But it's not an encouraging history. So if parvo isn't a concern in dogs, there's not like another ubiquitous unenveloped virus that's just around and a problem like there is with cats. These can be decent as sort of day-to-day cleaners, but if parvo is a concern, you either need to follow with bleach or you should just use a different disinfectant on a daily basis. And Excel HP, accelerated hydrogen peroxide, has a lot of the same good qualities of the quats in that it comes as a liquid, so you can use it in all the same systems and central systems or hose end systems. It's also a good detergent. It also has good activity in the face of organic matter. So that's a good substitute for a quat if you're in an environment where parvovirus moderately often rears its ugly head. This is the bleach family. So that includes bleach, WisiWash, and BrewClean. And they are proven effective against unenveloped viruses if they're used on a surface that's free of organic matter, they're correctly and freshly mixed up, and they're applied correctly for a sufficient contact time. So because they have no cleaning activity, they're limited in the number of environments where they're really going to be very useful. So when we have unenveloped viruses, the choices are bleach at a half cup per gallon. More is not better. So abrading the animals and staff's respiratory tracts with a high concentration only facilitates respiratory disease and doesn't help you kill any more parvo. So we never recommend it at more than a half cup per gallon except when you're trying to eliminate ringworm or accelerated hydrogen peroxide, trifectant, WisiWash, and BrewClean. That's the lineup of products that are reliable against unenveloped viruses and safe to use. So there are a few others that actually will work, but they're not safe to use around animals. Ringworm, the only thing right now that's proven reliable is cleaning, mechanical removal, and then bleach at 1.5 cups per gallon. So the only time we would recommend using that higher concentration, and that would be something to use when there's not animals present, when the environment has already been cleaned of animals. And then the good news about ringworm is that we have a great tool to just see, did you get rid of it? Instead of agonizing about cleaning and cleaning and cleaning, just do a culture of the environment, see if it's still there, then try a little harder, then do another culture. If you've got organic matter, then accelerated hydrogen peroxide and trifectant or a high quality, relatively expensive quaternary ammonium compound is going to be your best bet. If you've got unenveloped viruses mixed with organic matter, then we're going to drop out the quat as an option. And if you need something that's a combination of cleaner and disinfectant because staff time is very limited and they're not going to be able to do a two-step process, then trifectant, accelerated hydrogen peroxide, or a high-quality quat would be the best choice. And recognize, it's not perfect. When we go in and we test like a surface that's been cleaned with a real detergent and like really rinsed and wiped and then disinfected, we see a much higher level of elimination of pathogens than if it's just sprayed with a one-step cleaner disinfectant. But if the reality is it's only going to be sprayed with one thing, then make it one thing that has the best chance of working. Like we were at a shelter where they only had time to spray one thing, and so on one day they were spraying a detergent, and on the next day they were applying the disinfectant. So they were making sure the disinfectant was never applied to the pre-cleaned surface. And then on the next day they were spraying the deodorizer. That was a bad idea. Keep in mind that mechanical cleaning should not be underestimated. If your disinfectant doesn't work, but you just cleaned everything away, you just flushed it away or wiped it off, then that did the trick. You didn't need the disinfectant to actually chemically kill it. So the better job you do with mechanical cleaning, and the more mechanically cleanable the environment is, the less you need to worry about using harsh chemicals in the environment. Who sees a problem here? What's the issue? Right. Says here, alcohol. Actually says here, bleach. Does that look like alcohol or bleach? No, it's Rocal. So, and I told you about that shelter, that apparent outbreak that just happened because the lid fell off the bottle and it got too concentrated. We've seen outbreaks associated with just like losing the cup that was supposed to measure out the disinfectant, and then someone grabbed a different cup, and it was the wrong sized cup. So just making sure that the tools are appropriate. Bleach is inactivated by light, so it needs to be in a light-proof container. Just that will extend its life by a month and keep it active. So if you have bleach sitting in an exam on an exam surface and it's in a container like this that's transparent to light, it's not going to be in. So make sure that concentration is correct and make it really simple. Post instructions clearly. Lock measuring devices to the wall. And this is true in a vet clinic as well as in an animal shelter. Be careful about mixing. So bleach and trifectant together create a nasty fume that's unpleasant. It's not poisonous. Quats and detergent inactivate each other because quats are a detergent-based disinfectant. So if you mix them with soap, it inactivates the quaternary ammonium compound. Bleach and ammonia is a known, you know, that's pretty well known, that creates poison gas. You don't want to do that. Although just bleach on pee is not enough, and bleach with quaternary ammonium is okay. But be careful about mixing them in general. Make sure that you're using it for the correct contact time. We talked a little bit about that. Storage time and method, and then written post-it procedures for mixing it specifically, and like where to turn the dial on the little applicator thing, anything, make it really completely bulletproof. We were just at a shelter last week where, you know, again, putting a lot of time and effort into disinfection, and they had, on the written posted instructions, it said to turn a knob vertical to turn it on. And in fact, turning the knob vertical turned it off. So for the whole time that they've been using that method, which as far as the boss knew, was before she became the manager 5 years ago, they had been carefully turning it off every day instead of turning it on. It saved them a terrific amount in costs because they never used much disinfectant, but it really wasn't helping their situation. If you do have toxicity in this little kit, I don't know if you can appreciate this, but there's a little hole here where these pipes are coming out. And this was at our teaching laboratory, one of our teaching colonies of cats. And we had our quaternary ammonium disinfectant stored up in that little metal box. And we got a call again. This came as a virulent Khaleesi virus possible outbreak. And we went over there and we saw a little bit of disinfectant dripping down the wall. And he actually jumped up there and showed how he had put his little hand in through that hole, knocked the disinfectant over, and it just leaked down the wall. And then they got it on their fur and they licked it off their fur. But the great news is this can be very treatable. Remove the source, obviously. Dilute with milk or water if ingested. Bathe the animals. Give them broad-spectrum antibiotics to control secondary bacterial infections. And pain control, because those ulcers can be very severe and extend down the esophagus. And they should be better within just a few days. What is the required contact time for a disinfectant? How many of you say 1 minute? 10 minutes. 2 hours. It depends. Yes. All of those answers are correct sometimes. So, like, here was a study that looked at Vircon, which is another form of trifectant. This is a terrible laser pointer. Anyway, you can see that at 1 to 50 concentration, it had some efficacy at 1 minute, whereas at 1 to 500 concentration, we didn't see efficacy until 10 minutes for trifectant. And the same with bleach. At 1 to 50, we saw some efficacy at 3 minutes and greater efficacy at 10 minutes. And at 1 to 100, we didn't really see meaningful efficacy even at 30 minutes. And this was a similar study looking at accelerated hydrogen peroxide. And it partly depended on the virus type, too. So poliovirus, that's another unenveloped virus, and maybe harder to kill than some of the other viruses where we didn't see as much of a reduction in decreased infective dose with a 1 minute contact time. So the contact time you need really depends on disinfectant type. So some are just faster than others. I actually have a little mouse in my backpack that makes a mouse-shaped laser. I usually mouse use for my cat, but it's good for this too, but I can't find it right now. So some disinfectants are just faster than others. So accelerated hydrogen peroxide and trifectant are labeled for some uses at 30 seconds to 2 minutes. So if you have somewhere where you can't have a long contact time, you want to use a faster disinfectant. The temperature. So when it's cold out, everything takes longer to work. And so that means if you're disinfecting an outdoor area in the wintertime in Wisconsin, you've got to err on the long side on concentration, and you got to err on the high side of concentration and long side of contact time. The amount of organic matter that's present, not only does it inactivate disinfectant, it really slows it down. So if you have some place where organic matter can't be removed, you just be really attached to your cat tree and you don't want to get rid of it, disinfect it for 2 hours. You know, don't just leave it on for 10 minutes. So when it's cold, dirty, poor penetration, tough or unknown pathogen, err on the long side for contact time. If you have no time for contact, then you got to optimize the temperature, concentration, and product. So use the product at the highest concentration for which it's labeled if you don't have time for a lot of contact. And so that's something where, yeah?
You know, when I sprayed on the cages of the clinic I work at, it tends to dry before the contact time, and I spray a lot. I mean, what are your suggestions for something like that?
That's okay if it's drying, as long as it's still in contact with the surface.
And so it's kind of, oh.
Yeah. How about closure time? What is an old slide that was supposed to be closed until November 13th, 2004?
Hopefully it's open now.
Yeah. How long should an area be closed if it's contaminated with parvo? How long would be long enough? Like a year. Yeah. A year or two. So no sense in closing an exam room or a kennel that's been contaminated by something bad. If you're going to disinfect it and it's going to work, then it's going to work. If it's not going to work, it's not going to work, and keeping it closed is not going to change that. So sometimes I recommend that you do 3 full cycles of cleaning and drying just to give you 3 full chances to get in every nook and cranny. But if you need something open right away, you can go ahead and do those 3 full cycles all in one day. Ideally, maybe you would have 2 different people do it, but I think if you have somebody who's really invested in making sure that they clean every acre of that contaminated area, it can be okay even to have the same person do it. It just needs to be done 3 full times. And so the interesting study, contaminated fingers could sequentially transfer virus to up to 7 surfaces. And detergent-based cleaning with a cloth to produce a visibly clean surface consistently failed to eliminate norovirus contamination. Norovirus is very similar to feline Khaleesi virus and less durable than the parvoviruses. When detergent cleaning alone or combined bleach and detergent treatment failed to eliminate contamination from the surface and the cleaning cloth was then used to wipe another surface, the virus was transferred to that surface and to the hands of the person handling the cloth. So moistening anything helps it to transfer disease. It helps the disease to live and persist on that surface. So when you moisten your hands through hand washing, say, or through a hand sanitizer, helps your hands pick up pathogens, helps them survive, helps them transfer to your mouth and nose, and it helps them transfer to other animals. And the same is true of moistening an environment. You moisten a cloth, you wipe it on a cage, you wipe it on another cage, it helps that virus transfer from one surface to another. So using separate cloths from one cage to another, or using separate products, or if you're going to use something, like if you have to use a mop from one cage to another or one area to another, then you have to use a disinfectant that's for sure going to kill everything that's picked up. So you want to use broad spectrum disinfectants like Excel or trifectant that are pretty good also with organic matter. This was, we had an outbreak of Pseudomonas that actually crawled up dogs' feet and legs and then caused a fatal pneumonia in a shelter, and we cultured it right out of this disinfectant dispensing tube. So it just created a little bacterial colony and it was living merrily in there. And I showed you this earlier where we found this bacteria that was also a different bacteria but also associated with fatal pneumonia persisting in little puddles in the environment. So especially if you're having a disease outbreak, you need to really pay attention to not only disinfecting and cleaning but also thoroughly drying everything that is part of the disinfection process. And we've talked to shelters that ended up having to use towels or leaf blowers to get through and dry kennel floors that were just rough and difficult to clean, especially in a humid climate during a wet time of year. And then application method. You know, the quaternary ammonium compounds they have this issue with unenveloped viruses, but on the other hand, there's a lot of different ways to apply them, and so maybe even though they're not the ideal product, if they're applied correctly, at least they're doing no harm versus a mop bucket that's being dragged from one kennel to another. Instead of being used, say, in a hose-end applicator, that means you don't have to track in and out of kennels and use contaminated water. And this is Brew Clean. This is what we got for our local shelter, and look how happy she is. This is the roaming throwinator. And, you know, again, that's in the bleach family, so you have to pre-clean the surface. This is a shelter with old, cracked concrete floors. Really not the best product, because prison inmates do a lot of the cleaning, we needed something that had a sort of built-in application system. This has the cleaner and like a brush for the cleaner, and then the disinfectant wand, and it's all like labeled and preset, and it's tablets, so that it's not as easy to mess up the concentration. So we thought that was a pretty good product for them. Except when we came back and saw that it was empty. And that we didn't know how long, but it was certainly empty for the whole cleaning process that day. And for however many days before. And this was a shelter we visited recently. This is a big barrel, and it was empty. And they didn't know. So, right product, right process, but one key breakdown there. Surprisingly common. So that's one of the hazards of central systems, is that if the product isn't right there in the applicator, you might not see that it's just all on. You have to build that into the process. And then just thinking about what are the right places to clean. So I told you that little story about forgetting about the animal control vehicles. This is, we contaminate a little dog with glow germ, and you can kind of see the glow germ on her face. You know, when I was an animal control officer, I got poison oak from dogs who had been in it, and I always had poison oak here all summer long because that's where I would let them go. And I watched volunteers like carefully sanitize their hands and then hold kittens up against their faces. So just thinking about, you know, what are the different surfaces that get contaminated. Crates are often a culprit. Drains are a big culprit. Exam surfaces. But just to put things in a little perspective, here's the hand of someone who is fooling with a cat in a shelter. We often go to like great extents to try and put the kibosh on that activity. Even though, as sort of animal care professionals ourselves, how many of you don't feel some temptation when you see a cat in a cage to poke it? It's hard to resist. How many of you know someone who adopted a cat or fostered a cat because it chose them, because it reached out and grabbed them? I know I have, multiple times, and I'm still suffering the consequences. So it's important to allow this activity. So we have this little device that measures the amount of organic matter contamination on a surface. It doesn't tell you what it is, it just tells you how much there is there. So it's sort of a marker. If there was Paleocopenia ringworm, how much would be transmitted by each of these activities? Here's an animal care worker who's just in the middle of cleaning, and it wasn't not a posed picture. She just was removing this enormous cat from its cage for daily cleaning because she couldn't possibly keep it in the cage. There was no room for anything else in the cage. And she was earnestly wearing gloves. She was actually changing her gloves, but where else was the cat having some contact? Get out. That's good. So 66,899 units of organic matter contamination on the hand of someone who had not been cleaning all day, wasn't a shelter worker. She was a vet student who was along with us, and she just walked into the shelter clean that day. This was after petting heavily three cats through the cage bars. On the other hand, in the same square centimeters of the scrub top of that staff member, 2.36 million units. 35 times as much disease transmitted in contact with a 4-centimeter square patch of the scrub top as being petted three times by someone coming to visit. So if we can arrange a cleaning process that limits the amount of time we're doing this when we're at our most dirty, we can afford to let cats get petted a bunch of times. And this was a study that just showed the prevalence in a human hospital setting of MRSA on white coats. So just again, emphasizing the importance of clothing as a way that disease spreads around in hospitals as well as in shelters, but then, you know, again, we're not like clutching people against our white coats in the way that we're clutching animals. So we want to have you really think about changes of clothing, and I think this is one of the most underutilized things in sheltering and veterinary medicine to prevent substantial disease transmission. And it's cheap and it's easy. And it doesn't have to be between every animal, but it has to be between areas or between major blocks of activity. So prior to handling animals that are newly admitted to a shelter that have not been vaccinated, that have not had their health evaluated, put on a clean top. So easy. And something that covers the arms as well as the body. Prior to handling newly adopted pets or youngsters in whatever context, those are animals that don't have a full series of vaccines or can't be fully protected by vaccination. And so if you've got something, if you've been cleaning or working with sick animals, treating animals in the morning, and then you go and see a newly adopted pet or a juvenile animal and you don't throw on a clean top, you're potentially transmitting disease at a very high dose of that animal. So you put it on a clean exam surface and you're careful to wash your hand, but you have so much more on your clothing than are on the other surfaces that you're worrying about. And then after handling sick animals or performing euthanasia. So those are some of the highest risk activities for contamination. And the thing, I don't have it written down here, but I should. After cleaning, cleaning is the dirtiest activity that we engage in. We just get coated with litter particles and hair and dust. And then nothing fancy about laundry. Bleach, hot water, dry it in a dryer, it's gonna be fine. Unless you pack it in so tightly that there's clumps of poop still remaining when you pull it out. Just covered that. And just a couple of little known facts. Which is more effective to reduce bacterial count on vet students' hands in between handling patients? Hand washing? Who says hand washing? Alcohol hand sanitizer? You are, for the most part, right? So, even doing it correctly, which we rarely do, in a study at a vet school, alcohol hand sanitizer was more effective at reducing bacterial count than was hand washing. The caveat is that alcohol doesn't kill parvo or paedocopenia or ringworm, so it will just create a sticky surface for it to adhere to merrily and spread from one animal to another. So careful hand washing or a change of gloves between animals when you're dealing with something really serious. But appreciate that alcohol hand sanitizers can be pretty effective, and especially to protect people from transmitting disease to their own mouths from the animals, which is also important. And here, it's from a Japanese animal shelter, which makes hand washing look incredibly fun. And then, what about feet? Which type of foot bath was most effective, given what I've told you about the different disinfectants? Who thinks a quad foot bath? Any of you ever, do you use foot baths here? Rokel? Foot baths? Bleach? In this study, they didn't even try bleach because there was no reason to believe that bleach would be effective because it's inactivated by organic matter, which lives on feet. Or trifectant, or water, or all were equally ineffective. So what they found is that trifectant was a lot better than the quats in reducing the bacterial count on boots before and after using the foot bath. And this was even using the foot bath correctly because it was a large animal hospital and it was like really dunking them in and scrubbing them off, not like a little ceremonial dip on a faintly disinfected contaminated towel. But it didn't matter. Before and after the foot bath, even with a good disinfectant, it didn't impact the bacterial count that was tracked from the outside to beyond the foot bath. So, and that's just bacterial count that's not as persistent as parvo. So if you are really worried, then you need to use dedicated shoes or boot covers for an area. And that's why I say don't worry about it with cats for the most part. You don't worry about it with dogs if you have something serious like parvovirus or a diarrhea outbreak of unknown cause. And then maybe just say and don't use the foot baths because they're probably not going to help. They may create a false sense of security and they may just moisten your shoes and help you track things from one area to another. And here's some resources for evaluation, and we can certainly put up these slides or send them out to you if you would like to have a look at that. And as I said, we just updated our disinfectant chart on our website. What's come over me? Any questions? Yeah.
I'm sure it's very, very shelter dependent, but in general, do you find like a natural home for who should be in charge, quote unquote, of this at a shelter? I mean, is it something you think a shelter veterinarian should play a bigger role in, or where does it usually live?
I think that a shelter veterinarian who's knowledgeable about disinfection should play a large role in developing disinfection protocols. And oftentimes, it's the role of the shelter manager to sort of get the products and implement it and train the staff. But I think it should be in close consultation with a shelter veterinarian who knows about this stuff. So I think a caveat is that up until fairly recently, veterinarians have not always been the most knowledgeable, and a lot of shelter directors have felt like, the disinfectant company rep is more knowledgeable, but then, you know, the disinfectant company rep is going to sell you a story like kills all known germs, or it's called Parvisol, even though it doesn't kill Parvo. Won't talk about that. All right, thanks. I can stay for a few minutes if other people have questions, but I don't want you all feel free to wander off if you have other classes you have to get to. Yeah.
This is just, I mean, from a fostering perspective.
Yeah.
So when I foster kittens, I keep them in my spare bathroom, which has wood floors, wood trim, wood cabinets. So when you say that bleach is not good for cleaning wood, is mm-hmm. that because it's not effective on wood or because it's bad for wood?
It doesn't have good penetration. So wood is something that's not like a sealed, smooth surface like steel and laminate or your bathtub. And so for the wood, I think both in terms of gentleness on the environment and in terms of efficacy, trifectant or accelerated hydrogen peroxide would both be much better bets for you. And I think both of those products are very good for foster homes in general, because they're both labeled for use in carpet cleaners. And I use Excel now as like my main household cleaning product, because it's, you know, you've got to test it on your carpet first, but you can clean your car. You know, if you rescue a puppy and it blows out with diarrhea in the back seat of your car, and it spills out the back of the crate that you're using, you can use it back there, and it's environmentally friendly, and pretty non-toxic, it's easy to use, and it comes in lots of different forms. Accelerated hydrogen peroxide, and I am not associated with this company, by the way, but it also comes in this magical thing that's like a shampoo-minator. And so you can shampoo, and it like directs the shampoo into the dog's fur and swirls it all up, and it's peroxide paste. So it really brightens them up and makes them smell good too. And then at the same time, it vacuums them back up. So their trade name is Anavac. And they have a whole line of Anavac centers in Canada where you can like go take your dog and get it vacuumed. And it's great when you have a bunch of dogs that are exposed to parvo and you want to get the parvo off of them, because you can use a product that's actually parvicidal and it's safe. But it's also just nice to, you know, clean up and bathe dogs without having to have a whole grooming room. And the dogs don't tend to mind it as much. It's not water splashing all around. It sucks it right off, so they don't end up soaking wet. You don't have to put them in a cage all wet and deal with cage dryers and all of that. So a lot of nice different things about Excel. A little bit tricky to get right now, but I think it's going to be much more widely and easily accessible in the United States. But also trifecta comes in lots of different forms. It's something that's easy to send home with a foster parent to say, you know, here, this is just a great thing to clean up between and after, especially if you had some kind of problem like a litter that broke with Palin or something like that.
Just so when you said like nothing special about the laundry, is that even, let's say, if something tests positive for ringworm, do you just...
Hot water, bleach, dryer,
just
and be
once,
careful
once
about...
Once and you're done? Because like I've had a couple of litters that, you know, I've taken them home and 3 weeks later they're ringworm positive, and then I do get really paranoid about, like, I wash those towels three times over and bleach and hot water, and then I'm like, well...
We actually, when we first opened the trailer, Karen Moriello was really opposed to having fluffies in the trailer, and the volunteers had all made these beautiful little fluffies, and they wanted to have them in there, and Karen kept saying, no, no, no. And we had started with a rule that when it cultures positive, it has to go. That was the rule for anything the volunteers wanted to put out there in the treatment center. And so we, for a long time, cultured the fluffies on their way in and on their way out of the wash, and we never had one culture positive coming out of the wash and the dryer.
I think the most common problem that we see is one is overloading.
Yeah.
So if you overload, then it's going to just mechanically be protected from exposure to the hot water and the bleach. And the other one is the carrying dirty laundry and not dealing with what you're carrying. So we definitely see that. You carry a big bundle of dirty laundry, you throw it in there, you wash it, put it in the dryer, you pull it out wearing the same thing that you put it in with, and then it's recontaminated with something really durable like rainwarm that for you. So put something on and then throw that in after it.
Usually we have people bag up anything that has rainwarm, we have them put it in a bag right away and then empty the bag right into the machine.
But for your foster homes, tell them,
yeah.
Undress, throw everything in the laundry, and leap into the shower.